Remembrance Sunday service. For those of you at home who can't make it along this morning because of illness or because you're vulnerable or you're self-isolating, please be assured that you are missed and we will be praying for you, and we're looking forward to the days when we can all gather together in worship of God. And as we come to worship God, we do so as followers of Christ. And we are called to bring the light to all people. A hopeful understanding of our world, declaring that God called the created universe good. We are called to bring this hope in God with us wherever we go, declaring that God makes all things new again. And Jesus, he taught us that we should love God and love one another. So let's join together in our love of God and to worship and give thanks. And our call to worship this morning, it comes from Psalm 130, where we read, "Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins." So let's join together in worship now as we sing our opening hymn, "Thine Be the Glory."
Thank you.
Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Dear loving Heavenly Father, we praise and worship you, for you are our great and loving God. And we thank you this morning for sending us your Son, Jesus Christ, to show us your love and to help us to see how you want us to share that love with those around us. And Lord, we come before you now in Jesus' name, confessing that in our words and actions we have failed you. In our loving and forgiving, we have fallen short of your mark. In our believing and trusting, we have denied your grace and power. And Father, we lay before you now our sins that are clouding our relationship with you. And we thank you, Lord, that as we confess our sins, we are forgiven. So may we live as a community who know they are loved and forgiven because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. And Lord, we pray now that you would bless us with your presence this morning and speak to us through your word, that we may forgive and love others as you have done for us. And we ask that you help us to demonstrate your love in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we come now to our act of remembrance, and I'm going to invite Mr. Gordon Orr up to lay the wreath. So let us remember with gratitude before Almighty God all those who in the cause of peace and in the service of others they died for their country in the time of war, and all those who have given their lives in the service of their country and in their community, they shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. And when you go home, tell them of us and say, for their tomorrow, we give our today. Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord our God, we remember those whom you have gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May the same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all people, and establish harmony among the nations. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning, it comes from John chapter 15, verses 5 to 17. John chapter 15, verses 5 to 17. And these are the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. And my command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. Amen. And we thank God for this blessing of his word. Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord our God, your love embraces all of your creation, and your realm knows nothing of the borders we draw between nations. You have taught us that every woman, man, and child is our neighbor. You have commanded us to love without thought of our own security, glory, or gain. And Father, we revel in that you have pronounced your blessing not upon nations and armies, but upon the poor and the meek and the peacemakers. Father, we remember those who have lost their lives as a result of war. Young soldiers dispatched to faraway places, never to return. And civilians, young and old, caught in the crossfire of conflict. Lord, please bring healing to families torn apart by war. Comfort those who mourn for their loved ones. We remember those who have been psychologically wounded by the horrors of war, those who find themselves unable to live with the burden of what they have experienced or having lost a loved one. Loving God, we pray that you would bring healing to hearts and minds that are broken. Reveal to us your image deep within us and within every other human life. Father, we remember the ecological cost of war, the landscapes around the world that bear the scars of bombing, the soil and water poisoned by the chemical residue of weapons, the scorched earth churned to dust by heavy vehicles, the destroyed forest habitats of birds and creatures, and the innocent lives lost amongst the collateral damage. Father, we pray that you bring healing to your earth. Make a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. And we remember those around the world living under oppressive regimes or in the midst of violence and conflict. The millions displaced from their homes to refugee camps. The communities struggle on with their daily lives under the shadow of war, fearing for their lives and the lives of their children. Father, we pray for our servicemen who are still serving, Lord, and we pray that you would give them wisdom and guidance and a sense of security and knowing that you are always with them. Father, bring healing to nations where there is unrest. inspiring us a hope for a world where all can live in dignity and safety. Father, we remember those who campaign for peace, who seek and encourage reconciliation and non-violent resolutions to conflict. Those who raise their voices to declare that there can be another way, and those who, in their lives, model forgiveness that Christ himself taught and demonstrated. Lord our God, bring healing into our communities. Forgiveness where there is hurt, compassion where there is hatred, and love where there is fear. And Lord, as we turn to your word now, please open our hearts and minds by the power of your Spirit, that we may glorify you in all that we seek to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as a ministry student still in training, I feel very honoured and privileged to be able to lead worship today on this Remembrance Sunday. And I have to confess, this is the first time that I've led such a service. And as I prepared my sermon for this morning, I felt a sense of inadequacy. But I came across a short story that made me chuckle, and it might even help to explain. And the story, it's from a pastor who had led a remembrance service. And after the service, as the congregation gathered for refreshments, an elderly gentleman, he approached the pastor to compliment him on his sermon. So he did that, and then he went on to ask, "I just wondered how you managed to get through the entire sermon without any mention of the war." And the pastor, he quickly answered, "Sir, I wasn't born during the war times. How could I talk about it when I wasn't there?" And the gentleman, he stopped to think for a moment, and then he replied, "Oh dear, son, you're going to have a little bit of trouble at Christmas then." And this funny little story, it helped with some of my concerns, and I feel like it contains a very important lesson. As Christians, none of us, we were actually present for the events of that first Christmas, but we believe in the birth of Jesus Christ. We weren't present for his death on the cross, but every Easter we remember and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Saviour. And the reason for that, it is, regardless of experience, we remember those stories to help us build a solid faith. A faith based on the significant foundations that we read in our Bibles. And this can apply to Remembrance Sunday as well. And nowadays, it's virtually impossible to meet those people who witnessed life in World War I. And I certainly lack any qualifications that would equip me to present any depiction of life at that time. But that is why our act of remembrance, it is so very important. And as we remember the millions that gave their lives in the wars, we keep their memory alive. And by passing on stories of their courageous hearts and sacrificial minds, we remember their acts of selflessness and their sacrifice for peace in our world and the freedom that we have today. And on Remembrance Sunday, we honour those who lost their lives in the world wars. And on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, it represents the day that World War I ended. And when we add in the devastation of World War II, it represents some of the deadliest military conflicts in human history, with entire generations being lost in some instances. But as we think about history, even up to the present time, our minds must unfortunately and inevitably think about conflict and war. Since the fall of mankind, conflict, war, and the rise and fall of kingdoms has been part and parcel of our entire history. And as a consequence of living in a fallen world, our history is riddled with wars breaking out continuously in various countries. Many wars have been waged in the name of freedom, and despite the similarity in its sound, freedom is never free. And over the centuries, there has been immense bloodshed and countless lives lost. And for some, freedom has cost them everything. And on this Remembrance Sunday, we thank God for the thousands of men and women in uniform who have risked their lives to protect the freedom that we enjoy today. We haven't forgotten them. We recall their sacrifice. We thank God for what was given and what was done through them. Today, however, we also remember the cross, and we thank God for our Saviour who gave up his life for us. We have a lot of freedom, but the greatest freedom of all is being free from the penalty of sin and the power of death. This freedom was also not free, because around 2,000 years ago, a young man's blood was shed and his life was lost for our eternal freedom. And on the spiritual battlefield called Calvary, Jesus, he laid down his life for us, his friends, so that we could be free from sin. But what does that freedom look like? And in John 8, 34 to 36, it tells us the following. Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." You will be free indeed. What an amazing promise that lets us know that we will no longer be slaves to our sins, or even burdened down with insurmountable guilt and fear. All we have to do is have faith and trust in Christ. So let's look at a couple of ways in which we're liberated through Jesus. First, we have freedom from guilt. We no longer have to bury ourselves under our guilt and the shame of our past. Is there anyone here who could claim that there is nothing from their past that haunts them? Maybe you've said or done something that has really hurt someone. Maybe you feel like you've failed at parenting or marriage or even religion. Maybe you aren't the perfect Christian that you think you have to be. Anger, disrespect, adultery, or even rebellion against God. These are all very real examples of things we might end up feeling guilty about. So how do we get rid of these guilty feelings? The key word here is forgiven. The minute you confess with your mouth, your sins are forgiven. And 1 Corinthians 15 verse 57 says the following. "He is so rich in kindness that he purchased our freedom through the blood of his Son, and our sins are forgiven." And then in Ephesians 1 verse 7 we read, "Because of the work Jesus did in winning your freedom, you don't have to carry your guilt around with you. You can release it and be free." And there it is, freedom from guilt. Jesus, he won our freedom on the cross, and Paul's telling us that we no longer have to carry it around. Paul, he encourages us to be free in the knowledge that we are forgiven and we can release our guilt and no longer be burdened by it. But this isn't the only freedom offered to us. We're privileged with the freedom of consequence. Christ has paid our debts. We all know that every time we break the law, there will be a consequence, whether it's a fine or a prison sentence. We know there are consequences for our actions. And the guilt I just talked about, it's a consequence of our action, our sin. There might not be legal repercussions, but there are definitely consequences for that. The ultimate consequence for sin is death. And of course, I don't mean physical death, but eternal spiritual death. And Romans 6:23, it tells us clearly, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's a pretty severe consequence, and one that we could never pay for ourselves. Thankfully, we don't have to. Jesus, he's already suffered the consequences of our sin and paid our debt in full. We are free from the burden of consequence because Christ paid the penalty. It's not that the consequence is no longer required, but rather it's already been paid on your behalf. That is what happened when Jesus died on the cross that day. Jesus was receiving the consequence of my sin and yours. But don't get me wrong, when we continue to sin, there'll still be consequences. Of course, if you commit adultery, the consequence might be the breakdown of your marriage. If you cheat your taxes, there'll still be fines and penalties. But the eternal consequence of our sin has been covered. We no longer have to worry about eternal separation from God. So in Jesus we have freedom from guilt. Our past can no longer haunt us. We have freedom from the ultimate consequence of sin because Christ has paid our debt. The definition of freedom in its basic form is having the right to choose. Each and every one of us has this little thing that God gave us called free will. And free will is our freedom to choose. And we all have the same choices. Every single day of our lives, we can choose to accept Christ or deny him. When we choose to obey God or disobey him, there's another choice. We can choose to live a life of sin or to live a life with Christ. The choice is always ours. The problem is, one leads to bondage, the other leads to freedom. One leads to death, the other leads to eternal life. But why did Jesus give up his life for us to reap these benefits? Why did God send his only son? And in our scripture reading today, you might recall the popular line of scripture that Jesus said, John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And Jesus, he's sharing this message during the very last period of his ministry. And in today's scripture, the word love was mentioned 9 times. And we cannot fail to see that love is one of the central messages in Jesus' ministry. Love is the motivation for everything that Jesus has done for us. So let's think about his sacrificial love for us and how we as his friends can continue to remember that loving sacrifice. First of all, we need to receive his love. In verse 9, Jesus, he says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. So we are abundantly loved by God, and this is an important message that we teach our children in our church from a very early age. And my grandparents, They took me to church from a very early age. And I don't know if that's everyone's experience, and I'm not sure if yours will have been the same as mine. And I know this one might be deemed old-fashioned nowadays, but I distinctly remember one of the very first Sunday school songs that I learned was Jesus Loves Me. And the origin of that song, it first appeared in a children's book written by Anna Warner in 1859. Her sister Susan asked her to write a song to comfort a dying child. Anna wrote a poem, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So. And these simple words, they not only moved the hearts of a number of children, but also touched the hearts of many, many adults. The powerful chorus, Yes, Jesus Loves Me. It makes us smile and encourages us of the assurance of God's love for each and every single one of us. This simple song, it's been translated into more languages than any other hymn because it is the most profound message. Jesus loves me. Receiving and remaining in his love, it's the most important step in having a relationship with God. Jesus explains it this way in verse 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So when we have an intimate relationship with Christ and abide in him, his love is conveyed in our hearts. Secondly, we need to reciprocate his love. In verses 14 to 15, Jesus says, You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. And in Jesus' day, the disciples of a rabbi or a teacher, they were generally known as his servants. And in Ephesians 2, verses 4 to 5, the Apostle Paul, he says, Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And then he also tells us in Romans 5, verse 8, But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So according to the scriptures, we were God's enemies due to our sins. However, our Lord, he willingly laid down his life for us on the cross and changed the whole relationship between himself and his disciples. And in our deeper relationship with God, Jesus, he promotes us from servants to his friends. And one day, one of the Pharisees came to Jesus and he asked, Of all the commandments, which is the most important? Jesus replied, The most important is this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. That's Mark 12, 28 to 30. Jesus didn't say, Be faithful to God, sacrifice yourself for the sake of God, devote your life to God, and offer all your possessions to God. Of course, these are all important things to God and to us. Jesus commands us to love God with all our hearts, souls, minds, and strength. And since God is one, our love must not be divided between Creator God and other idols. We have only one heart. And when something else captures our heart as the first priority, we cannot love God with full devotion or give it a just place in our hearts. And let me ask you this, and I ask myself this as well. Do you truly love Jesus more than anything else in the world? Jesus, he wants to hear our confession of love for him. And I read somewhere recently that sin is not just breaking the commandments of God, it's breaking the heart of God. Sin, by its very nature, is not only against law, but it's against love. That's why we need to examine whether our hearts love anything more than Jesus. And thirdly, we need to recycle the love of God as we continue to receive and reciprocate his love. Jesus repeatedly commands the disciples throughout today's scripture, "This is my command, love each other," verses 12 and 17. Once we have received the love of Jesus into our lives and returned our love to him, then we're able to share that love with others. And in verse 12, he clearly commands us how we should love other people by saying, "Love each other as I have loved you." And in our human nature, we do tend to find it difficult to love or even like everyone. When we remember his abundant love for us, however, we can and should love each other. Do you know how many times we have sinned against God since we were born? And the psalmist, he says this, "Troubles without number surround me. My sins have overtaken me and I cannot see. They are more than the hairs of my head and my heart fails within me." That's Psalm 40, verse 12. So we commit an immeasurable number of sins, but our Lord God is love and forgiveness. He loves us in spite of our sins when we come to him and we repent of them. And today we remember and honor those who have sacrificed their lives for the great cause of freedom and peace. Freedom and peace that every single one of us enjoys. So let us express our appreciation for our Lord Jesus Christ as well. And for Christians, every Sunday is Remembrance Day. It is the day when we remember the sacrifice of Jesus, who died for our sins on the cross, and who has brought peace between God and us, as well as between the people. So let's pray that he may use us to make our family and our community more loving and peaceful as we keep receiving the love of God, reciprocating his love, and recycling this love with others. Let's pray. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for revealing your unconditional love to us through your word. And we thank you for making it possible for us to continue to share your word with those around us. And as we go about the rest of our day and week, Father, we pray that you would open our eyes so that we can follow you faithfully. Let those listening today with broken hearts respond to your word, that they feel revived and restored. And help us all to continue living and walking according to your word, and not by what we see. Father, help us to turn our eyes away from worthless things so that we can focus on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. So let's join together in singing a hymn that reminds us of the goodness, faithfulness, kindness, and majesty of God. We are reminded that our only hope, our only comfort in both life and death is through Jesus Christ. Let's sing together, "Abide with Me." Folks, if you would please stand at the close of the benediction for the national anthem. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
Send her.
seated, folks.